Okay. Does it work? The microphone? Yeah, but I don't know. Well, okay. So good. That's fine. So thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you, Sam, because you set perfectly the scene. And actually, I really just could add a couple of slides, and then my business is done. So I will try to take from where Sam has left the audience, and try to go really into the issue of forecast and what does it mean to do forecast or predictions. And this is something that it's obviously has a lot of implication for epidemic modeling, as well more in general for social systems. Let me say immediately that I need to thank a large number of people for what you will see during my talk. This is work that started more than 10 years ago with a number of PhD students, postdocs, collaborators. I have three people here actually with me. It's very nice from the Complex System Center here to organize this kind of team meetings. I have Matteo Chinazzi, Anna Pastore, and Chan Zhang, who are now the real engine of many of the things that we're doing. And I will mention today some work that we did on Ebola, specifically under the umbrella of the MIRAS initiative, that is an NIH Center of Excellence for the modeling and statistical analysis of infectious diseases, in collaboration with also Beth Halloran, Ira Longini, two foundations in Italy, and the INSERM in France. So let me start from here, because, you know, when we talk about prediction, in a sense, we go immediately to the prediction that we are used to in natural sciences. And in natural science, we are very, very spoiled. You know, we just get the eclipse of the moon with what I would call infinite precision, in a sense, years in advance. And then obviously we can relax a little bit the things, we can think about stochasticity, and then we have weather forecast. And now, you know, each one of us goes on a device, and, you know, at the fingertips you find what happens in the next couple of days, 1 week, even 10 or 15 days. We are all, we are so used to think in terms of weather forecast that we know that the next couple of days the predictions, the forecast will be very good. And then if we think about 2 weeks ahead, probably, well, we have not to take so seriously what is there, and so on and so forth. So really something that that it's embedded in our way of thinking. But then when we move into many other areas, actually we do not have control at all. So if you think about conflicts, if you think about the spread of consensus, the information, how we manage crisis, the next pandemic, etc., we have not that kind of forecasting power at all. And actually, we are not even able, in many cases, to forecast the next traffic jam. So that, in a world that we know is more and more interconnected, and we see more and more how, in some cases, little events can trigger major avalanches on the interconnectivity of the system. So why is that? Well, that is for a simple reason, because now we are talking about system where we are part of the problem. We, in the sense of the social atom, so the individuals. And obviously, you can imagine that, you know, we are not as simple as atoms, as the classic physical atoms. Although, if you go back to sociology, and I don't want to go back to 100 years or more, although there is a large history on that, about, I would say, what I would call social physics. Even just by going back 100 years, you go to Lundberg or Moreno, that were depicting the construction of physics of society by talking with the social atom, and they were arguing that actually for 90% of the things we are doing, we are not so different, unfortunately, and or fortunately. And then we can look at the molecules. The molecules is the household, the workplace, the school, etc., etc. And then from the molecules you assemble a social aggregate, and you could try to think about understanding the evolution of the social aggregate and the phenomena in the social aggregate as a resulting bottom emerging phenomena from the social atom. Well, so let me, however, go into the specific example of forecast. And I'm sorry, yeah, some of the things might be a little bit odd. We have to put my presentation in another laptop, so in some cases, some of the things are not perfectly tuned. But so, you know, here is a comparison between what happened in the last, you know, century, basically on numerical weather forecast and numerical epidemic forecast. So you see that we start with in 1920, when actually, you know, Richardson decided to integrate manually the constitutive equation for atmospheric development. That's it took, I think, a couple of weeks or more to forecast one point for pressure somewhere. So, and this was a massive calculation, pencil and paper. The results was wrong in the end. Not just because of the physics, but actually because of really, you know, the problem of calculating something so big. And actually also went on figuring out how many people we would need to make real time forecast. I might be wrong, but it was talking about 60,000 people arranged in a kind of stadium-like geometry, doing calculations by hand, you know, and exchanging data. There were coordinators. So, you know, it was envisioning something that was parallel computing made with people. Well, what was happening at the same time in epidemiology, well, in epidemic modeling, yes, that in 1930, Reed Frost have the first model that actually introduces stochasticity in the contagion. It's a very nice, simple model. It's an SIR model. It's along the lines of what we have been talking before. And actually was implementing the random version by using a sandbox computer. That means that he was really using a sandbox. He was extracting was doing random events, extracting red or black bolts from an urn. So really something that was, how to say, low technology, but very, very effective. Well, what happens in the 50s, people start to really believe about weather forecasts. And so, you know, 24-hour computation for a 24-hour forecast, so obviously completely useless. But you see that we were getting there. At the same time, first Reed Frost numerical implementation. Now there is a computer, so we can do things numerically. But then there is some discontinuity. You know, 1955, already we get, you know, prediction models that become operational. And actually, you know, instead, in this time break here, obviously, a lot of complications to the models. We have done a lot of I would say improvement to the modeling of each specific disease, getting clinical data, et cetera, et cetera. But if you think about forecasts, no, they were not there. You know, and now if you think in 2015, we are where we are, we can get weather forecasts for all our activities at our fingertips. While if you think about what happens in epidemic modeling, this is completely, completely different situation. And, you know, this was in the 50, you know, a weather, numerical weather control center. You know, in the 50, there was nothing like that for epidemics. And actually, unfortunately, there is not even something like that nowadays for epidemic. Well, in the last 10 years, something has changed, however. And finally, you know, one of the big hurdles that we had to study society is falling apart. What is one of those big hurdles? It's data. How we collect data on millions of individuals at once. And this is crucial. If we want to understand, you know, and do forecasts in any realm where the social atoms is relevant, we need to get an understanding of the laws that characterize the social atom, the society. And, you know, big data is, I think, summarizing that. You know, every year, basically, we produce more socioeconomic data than in the entire previous history of the humankind. And these are data that now we have the computational power to analyze. And so this is obviously a big game changer. And we have data of all kinds. And let me stress, as Sam was doing, most of those data point to the importance of networks. So let me do a few examples. This is data that, for instance, you can gather about face-to-face interactions with RFID tags, but these very little tags. This is an experiment carried out by a group in Italy, in Turin, that is called Social Pattern. And you can measure, you know, how, you know, students in classes meet with each other on a scale of a few seconds. You can distinguish, you know, when class is meeting, when there is recess, when they go to lunch. And you know, you can measure in a very accurate way all those interactions that obviously are in the shape of a network. So we have point-to-point interaction. I talk with somebody, then I turn my attention to somebody else, then I go and play soccer with other 10 kids. But this is a constant changing dynamic network, exactly as Sam was pointing out before. Well, this was recess time, you see, where everything gets mixed up. We can go at a more microscopic level. And this is the city of Paris during the Night of the Music. This is a big festival in the city. And these are traces from mobile phones, where, you know, you can look at people and how they move from one place to another in the city. You can track their mobility with almost infinite precision. You know, the precision of the GPS that and the mobile that is in our mobile devices, with the things that you see. Then people disappear in the subway, they reappear from other places, with all the complexities that we can map now about human mobility. Again, this is our network of interactions, of movements that is crucial for the disease spread. Well, we go on another scale, and this has been mentioned by Sam too. We can get data on all airlines in the world and how flights comes from Europe to the United States, how they take off in each airport in the United States, how many people are flying on any segment, how many people are flying from one place to another through different gateway airports, and so on and so forth. So this all creates a description of those interaction systems that are crucial to understand disease forecast, as well as other processes in the social aggregate. Well, where is the network important? So this is the simple example I always put forward. This is the spreading of the Black Death in Europe in the 14th century. And obviously, you see, it's very like throwing a stone in a pond. You see this wave that moves and sweeps Europe, actually killing about 40 to 50% of the European population, something that our society would not withstand today. You know, at that time, you know, in a much less evolved society, there was much more resilience in a sense, because Europe didn't, you know, disappear because of that. But you see, you can, there is such a good documentation on this epidemic, because in every little town in Europe, you can still find documents about that Black Death, that you can calculate, for instance, what was the velocity of spreading of that wave. And this is about 4 miles per day. So you see immediately what it is. These were, you know, the distance that people were doing, walking or, you know, by slowly moving from village, to trade, to do movements, and then bringing the disease with them, with the rats that were traveling with them, and so on and so forth. So, obviously, it's a complete different process from what you see in 2002 for SARS, for the SARS epidemic starting in Hong Kong. Actually, SARS started in China. There is a very fuzzy picture of what happened in China before. At a certain point, it gets to Hong Kong, and from there, United States, Canada, back to the Far East, in a way that seems completely erratic. Well, it's not erratic. It's that actually what you are doing is that in one case, you are looking at a physical system like a wave in a pond. In the other case, you are looking at something that is a wave in a network. And these are completely different process that keeps into account very different metrics, very different underlying substrate. And so this is the importance of network that, as Sam was saying, we need to include in our picture of diseases. Well, this network structure actually is at the very large scale, but is reverberating until the very, very microscopic scale. You know, when you create synthetic population, that is what you want to do when you try to get a network epidemiology description of a disease, what in principle you should do, and it's not always possible, is to look at the society in this way. So you should map each specific household with individuals tagged with the age, the sex, and where they belong geographically. And then you should add what is the functions that each person does every day. So the kids go to school, perhaps some adults go to teach in that school, and then there is a workplace, people go to the workplace, and so on and so forth. What you do? Well, you create at the end a very large bipartite networks in which you have individuals, and that those individuals visit specific location. Obviously, the co-occupancy in some places define the contact pattern among those individuals. Obviously, if you are in the same household or if you spend time in the same school, you are in contact. What you can do is simply to do what we call the unipartite projection of those networks and get, for instance, what is the interaction map of which Sam was talking before. You know, and this is a very complicated interaction pattern in which you have different colors for the connection, because obviously your interaction in the household is different than the interaction in the school. It's different if you are 5 years old or if you are an adult. Obviously, you know, the way you behave when you are 5 years old in kindergarten is very different from how we behave on the workplace and, you know, in the spreading of the disease. This might be very important. And so you can have this description as well. Now you can add many more descriptions like multiplex networks, multi-layer networks, etc., etc. But actually, at the end, what you are trying is to conceptualize the disease spreading on this substrate, because this is what we want. And as we have seen in previous talk, the network structure is heavily affecting the feature and the patterns created by the disease. Well, when we talk about forecast, there are many ways of talking about forecast. And, you know, again, Sam was giving a great introduction on what to do when you have a time series. It's fantastic. The issue is that when you do time series analysis, there are a lot of problems. In many cases, you do not, first of all, you are completely agnostic to the physics or the mechanic. Very good algorithms take a time series, and they will do the prediction for the next two or three time steps, whatever is the signal. You don't care about that. You can put more information and get better forecast, but still is a time series analysis, and there is a problem of what is the actual information you are getting from the signal. It's great that Sam was able to show how, you know, you in a sense you are not getting more information by adding more time to the time series, because that's really is one of the fundamental assumptions of all the training sets and etc. in sample, out of sample prediction, and so on and so forth. There is, however, it has been proposed in the last years to circumvent this problem by not looking at the time series itself, but by using proxy or surrogate data coming from other sources. For instance, this is the major idea of Google Flu Trend. You get a signal about queries about the flu, you train the signal on the actual CDC influenza-like illness prevalence, and then you try to use the proxy signal as an indicator and then a predictor of the actual time series. Why you do that? Especially because you have, in many cases, you can get the proxy signal in real time, something that you don't have in many cases the luxury to be able to do with the CDC signal that aggregates sentinel data from doctors, etc. And at this point, even 1 or 2 weeks difference may be crucial. However, there are many other caveats. Here, too, again, it's difficult, and you are using techniques that in many cases are modeling agnostic, so they don't they completely forget about what Sam was showing, so the networks, how people get replaced on the workplace, the parameters of the disease. And then also we need to be cautious on how we use proxy data. There is a very nice paper by Marcel Salatin and collaborators that show how the Twitter signal correlates perfectly with the seasonal influenza. But if you, by looking on Twitter on people talking about influenza, but then it took the signal of people talking on Twitter about zombies, and that signal was correlating even better than the signal on influenza. And so you start to get, you know, some understanding that obviously there must be issues. You know, one of the hypothesis is that since there is a series about zombie in November, December, you know, a lot of people is talking about that TV series exactly at the moment in which, you know, the epidemic is generally ramping up, and you get a very high correlation. So you need to, there are a lot of subtleties, and we cannot imagine that, you know, we can just circumvent the problem of information statistics by using proxy data, of which I'm a big fan, I have to be honest, you know, so I want to use those data, but we need to be careful. And then, you know, here probably comes my physicist background. You know, for me, predictions and forecast means also that I understand the mechanic and the dynamics of the system. So we do prediction on hurricane paths, not because we do time series analysis, or not because we just do that, but because we understand the atmospheric equations, because we understand the physics of weather. And so, you know, we want to go in that direction. And to go in that direction, if you really want to do something that is detailed, that is extremely accurate, you need to go into what we call micro-individual simulations, individual-based or agent-based simulations that actually are trying with different approaches, different assumptions, different philosophy behind, to recreate a synthetic world in the computer, to initialize that synthetic world with the best data you find from the real world, and then try really to do what numerical weather forecasts do every day, create ensemble output of what could be the unfolding of the epidemic. Well, there is an issue, and these are the issues that you have dealing with the social systems. First of all, these are data-hungry models. So we need a lot of data on people, and we can work out on those. But we need also a lot of data on how we behave and adapt to the information. This is usually the big elephant in the room when you do forecast for epidemic. So the hurricane doesn't care if we forecast its path. Obviously, instead, if I have forecast of a major epidemic, people will behave differently than changing the forecast. And so this is something we will take on a little bit later. But so this is what we started to do 10 years ago. We did say, okay, we really have to take all these and, you know, start collecting data, start to create this synthetic world by looking at different layers of data from the population that you can get from various experiments at a very fine grain up to 5 by 5 kilometers, infrastructural data, mobility data, commuting, airline patterns, etc., etc. You create a synthetic world where people travel, you know, billions of people travel, meet, connect every day. And then on top of this world, you can include the disease model. The disease model, there is no model that fits all disease. Each disease has its own model, its own parameters, its own natural history, and it's specific, and each specific outbreak has specific initial conditions. So if we are able to plug this into the model, then we can hope to do forecast. Well, what you do at this point, if it goes on, is to create a model in which you have a specific architecture. This is a large-scale computational platform. You get demographic data, mobility data, epidemic model, and then you do individual level simulation. So you follow microscopically each individual. There are two dynamics, and our approach was to use what we call a kind of metapopulation approach. We monitor about 4,000 census areas in the world in 220 countries, mapping you know, about 90% of the population in the world. And then we microscopically model the travel of people from one of these census areas to the others, the commuting patterns, and then the evolution of the epidemic inside each of these census areas. Obviously, you can do all your tests about how to do for containment policies, vaccination policies, et cetera, et cetera. The final outcome is prediction, is an output that is a stochastic output that tells you, you know, how many cases will be imported in one place, what is the prevalence, et cetera, et cetera. If you want a little bit zoom in, for instance, in the United States, these are all the census areas that we that we monitor that basically are centered around major transportation hubs or major urban areas. Then there is the commuting grid pattern among the various areas, the travel by airlines. We integrate the entire International Aviation Association database in real time. And then you have the disease. This is a very simple disease model for influenza-like illnesses with symptomatic individuals. And then you have to parameterize that with data coming from the field. Well, you can zoom in and go into, again, what is really actually under the hood. Under the hood is hundreds of thousands of stochastic processes, because we keep to the stochastic and integer nature of individuals. You can imagine in a pictorial way that the disease moves from one region to another because of those infected people traveling. The problem is always that you need to have something that at this point is data-driven from the outset, because you are using data from the real world. But then you need real data and possibly accurate data about the disease you want to model. What is the game? The game is the following. You, at the end, you have a platform that really, like in weather forecast, provide you the projection of how many cases will be in a certain area, how people have gone from one place to another, et cetera, et cetera. Let me tell you something. Now, when we talk about epidemics every time, since for us is much better in a cognitive way, we project the epidemics geographically. We have places, we have areas, et cetera, et cetera. But actually, the model and the way you are modeling all this process is a network process in which you have census areas, people connecting in those census areas. It's a network of network, and then those census areas are connected through the traveling of people, et cetera, et cetera. You have just a logical, in the end, model that connects all those networks and the evolution on those network patterns. And then you map, you know, in the real world so that you can understand in a cognitive way what's going on. Well, this is an example. This is something that we did a few years ago about modeling a very highly pathogenic virus spread from London. And you can you see what is that. There is the outbreaks in London. And then you can follow, at this point, single individuals on single segment of travel going from one place to another and then seeding the disease in other places. You can go at this microscopic level. Obviously, you have to imagine that every time that you do such a simulation, you are performing one of currents of that epidemic. But this is a stochastic event. You can generate thousands of that epidemic. Each one of them will be different. And what you have to get is statistical ensembles of those simulations so that you hope to extract what is called a backbone of that event, of that outbreak. Obviously, there will be fluctuations. But if there is any meaning in a model and any hope of making forecasts in epidemics, we need to have recurring patterns that are much more likely than others. And this is indeed the case. That's because the coupling among different regions in the world are very heterogeneous. New York and Paris and major cities have a lot of people traveling on those connections. At the periphery, you rely more on the spreading pattern driven by commuting mobility. And so at the end, you create ensemble forecasts that will give you stochastic ranges about what could happen for the disease. Well, generally at this point, you know, people is telling me, okay, we know about those things. This is like, you know, like SimCity. You know, there are very nice video games about that. Can you, what are you telling that? Well, you know, the idea is that at this point you have to really validate what you're doing, and then you validate by doing real-time forecast, trying to put in the field the forecast, you know, and possibly not just doing historical backtesting or calibration. And so the first time we used this model in a real-time situation was in 2009 for the H1N1 pandemic. I spare to you all the issues that you have when you work on real-time. So what are the parameters, specific parameters for that strain? What is the effect of seasonality? And so you have to rely on a lot of data, do a lot of calibration from data coming from the field. But at the end, if you have 1 month, 2 months worth of data, you can start really to crunch numbers and try to see how the epidemic evolves. And this is something that we did. We worked in June to understand what was the epidemic peak of the epidemic in the northern hemisphere for the winter wave that was also supposed to be the largest, how to say, the strongest blow to in terms of attack rate. Well, we did that for all the countries in the northern hemisphere, and these were our predictions. And you would say, well, they are all pretty much consistent and they are all around November, but here you see there is a problem. And the problem is that actually November is not when you expect to have the peak of seasonal influenza. Generally, seasonal influenza is much later, December, January. But like this year, you can have, you know, something in March or April. So this was actually an anticipated peak. Look, in the model, we keep into account seasonality. So we have seasonal forcing that actually should produce a peak in January, February. But, you know, this seasonality forcing plays in a nonlinear way with all the other things of the disease, the parameters of the disease, the initial condition, the seasonality in other places, and so on and so forth. And so you say, well, that was a result that was puzzling initially for us. We published these results before the epidemics, before the peaks, so in September, I think, and then we made this data available in June. Luckily enough, we were comforted because other people and other modeling groups were getting similar results, in a sense. And this is the experimental data. So in red, you see what all the signals that we have been able to collect from surveillance systems in the various countries. And you see that in most of the cases, you are right on the, what is this? On the week. And obviously, you will see also that in some places you might not be so good. For instance, in Mongolia, we are a couple of weeks out of the confidence interval. But then you have also to account for the various fuzziness of data that we have. Mongolia is not probably the region for which we get the best data in the world. You know, there are other things like the 2 weeks shift in France. We were not aware of that, French people start school in September, but mid-October they go on vacation for 2 weeks. So that obviously creates a slowdown of the epidemic because there is no school that is obviously the hot place for epidemics. And so you see, this is what's comforting. We are moving in the right direction. So this is something that, you know, can be actually used to do forecasts. Another example, and this is more current, is the Ebola epidemic. So now I suppose most of you have been following the news during the past year, so you know about the Ebola epidemic. It's a disease that is in an animal reservoir, could be bats, could be primates. For the first time, spread through West Africa, while actually has always been more typical in a remote region of Central Africa, and creating, you know, a large outbreak that was, in a sense, unprecedented and that caught everybody unprepared. Mostly for the reasons that Sam, you know, if you really go to the bottom of the question, what was the preparation for this perfect storm? Well, yeah, about 20 years of wars and countries in a total disarray. So what happened? Yeah, at this point you have to do early stage modeling, as we said. And the point is that what are the two things you want to do? You want to understand how the epidemic's trajectory will unfold within West Africa, that was the hot spot. And then at the same time you want to create an assessment of the potential pandemic that you might have if people start traveling, bringing the disease across the world. And unfortunately, it's a disease with a large incubation period so that people infected but unaware of the infection could be on a plane and travel somewhere else, as it we have experienced. So what is the problem now? And this is where with the problem of doing real-time forecasts. You don't have a lot of data initially. So again, I think this is another problem with infectious disease forecast and analysis. the real-time surveillance. So in those most of the regions of the world, there is no infrastructure to get timely surveillance. There is a lot of underreporting of cases. And then you get also something that is inherent to any disease if it's an emergent infectious disease. You might not know the etiology of that disease. And so you need time to build the statistics about how long is the incubation time, what is the mechanism of transmission, et cetera, et cetera. Luckily enough, for Ebola, we had a lot of that. And so you can start and do modeling. Indeed, I remember at that time, in many endless calls with the MIRAS group, with Sam and the other people, we were all complaining about the lack of data. But now that I'm going through another of this issue, that is the Zika epidemic, the one about the mosquitoes in Brazil, I have to say that at that time we had plenty of data with respect to now. So you see that you can at least go to the historical outbreaks. There were measurements. There were an understanding of the mechanism of transmission. Data in West Africa, especially again because of new technologies, because we at a certain point had to find hospital places in Liberia and Guinea and Sierra Leone. And if you go to how to say, official website, you don't find that information. Then you go on OpenStreetMaps and you find all the hospitals mapped with a GPS coordinate. So you see that now technology, even in those remote places, allows you to do a lot of work. Well, obviously you have to use a specific disease structure. For instance, for Ebola, it was crucial to have the funeral as one of the possible setting for transmission. The household was another crucial setting, obviously, as well as hospitals that were not prepared to host Ebola patients. And so this is different from Ebola treatment units where there was a pipeline and so on and so forth. So we build that model, and then at that point you are left with a few parameters like the transmissibility in those settings that is specific not just to the disease, but as Sam was saying, to the social context. You might have the same virus and biologically it has the same transmissibility, but your culture, your way of dealing with the dead body, the way of dealing in the family, in caregiving, et cetera, produce different evolution of the disease. And so we had to calculate, we have to estimate that from simulations and from numerical tests. What you do is that there are many techniques. So what we are doing, just to give you an idea, is to use this model, perform a sampling of the parameter space, and then in a sense, you generate thousands of synthetic epidemics, and then statistically, you look at those epidemics that more closely resemble the signal that you get up to that point, and then you do a model selection. Those epidemics are very likely the one that best describes the epidemic. You can single out the parameters of those epidemics, and then use those parameters to make a forecast and analysis. And one of the first things that we do is a model calibration on West African cases. And we start also to project, the next few points. So you evaluate, you do the model selection procedures, and then you can start to say, okay, how many cases we will have next week, in 2 weeks, in 3 weeks, et cetera, et cetera. There were many modelers doing that, obviously. And I think here is interesting again, because we are doing this modeling with a model that has the mechanism of the infection. It contains the information on the dynamics of the disease. There is a microscopic process underlying the forecast. Here you see how you then can do those in time. And here I'm just reporting all the results, how they have, the sliding window is our prediction and then what happened in reality and so on and so forth. You see that in some places you can do very good. In some other places, from time to time, you can be off. Well, this is, I would say that is not too bad, because even when you are off by, 5,000 cases, et cetera, here we have to renormalize our understanding of forecasting an epidemic. It doesn't have to be 923 cases. You have to be on the order of magnitude. You have to be able to project what is going to happen, you know, in terms of what you are really interested in, that is not, you know, the single counts, especially in cases like this one, where probably the underreporting is of the order of 20 or 50%, or so really huge underreporting. Well, the problem is, at this point, is this one also, that while forecasts can be pushed a lot in advance in certain areas, for the epidemic forecast, you cannot expect to say for a disease like Ebola in June what will happen in December or January. This is such a deadly disease that people behave will change, that intervention on the field will start. And so having something that predicts the next 2, 3, 4 weeks is probably what you can do at the most in some cases. This is different, for instance, from the pandemic of 2009. The long-range prediction there were accurate because after a couple of months, everybody understood that there was no big danger, and actually the social adaptation was minimal to that, to the disease. Well, there is, however, something more. And this is what I want to stress, because we are talking about prediction and forecast, and I think in disease we need to change a little bit and bend the idea of forecast. So there is not just forecast. You know, disease modeling produces many other things that are extremely relevant, like situational awareness, intervention planning, projections that are not forecast. Projection is what-if scenarios, you know, and what also we call structured reasoning. We had to fight hard during Ebola, and we wrote, this is our ideas that I got from a paper that we wrote within the MIDAS collaboration framework. And let me give you a few examples. I have still 4 minutes, and then I'm going to close quickly. So the situational awareness, for instance, you can do longer range projections, but at that point you need to do that with kind of scenarios and say, okay, if I have the status quo scenarios in which I have an exponential growth of the disease, that will be the trajectory. If I have marginal containment, I will find this trajectory. If I have full containment, the other trajectory. And then you can look at the data coming from the field and say, oh, well, good, look, the data points are below the exponential growth. So we are doing something that is effective. You know, we might be better in this regime at this point, or we could actually get into this regime at certain point. And you have a situational awareness given by the simulation and the comparison with the reality. The situational awareness goes also, for instance, in the international travel. We monitor the probability of getting the importation of one or more cases in each country, and you can start looking at what is this probability in different months. And then you see, for instance, that it was not, we never had for each specific country huge probability of importation of cases. Well, 10% obviously, or 5% when you talk about Ebola is a lot. You know, it's a tangible risk. But obviously it's not, you know, a redundant 90%. And actually it was even more interesting because if you look at the number of cases that you can expect, immediately you see that you can have one or two importations per month at the beginning of the epidemics. And then if the things get better, you keep on that level. Obviously, you can also project what would happen if we are not able to contain the disease at the source. That was the main things to do at that time. Yeah, well, then at that point, you know, by December, January, you would have hundreds of cases circulating in the system. But that's, you know, is where you get to your understanding of what could happen and how compare the reality that you see with those scenarios. You can analyze things like what is the effect of traffic restrictions. And you see that in a status quo exponential growth, traffic restrictions are really not very effective. Even if you get a 90% traffic restriction, you can get a delay of the epidemic of 3 or 4 weeks, not much more. Although you can show that, for instance, traffic restriction is more important in a scenario in which you don't have the exponential growth, but you are in a kind of marginal containment. At that point, really, traffic restriction and screening can help, you know, in buying you time for the disease. it's also important to look at the nonlinear thinking in these terms. You know, complex systems, I think you are all well aware, you have one of the prominent, the most prominent complex system center in this university. So, you know that in those systems, nonlinear linear thinking in many cases doesn't work. And one of the situations in which you see that is that when you have spreading across networks, you know, the fact that you close down traffic up to 90% or 80% doesn't, you know, these are major changes to the system that just project into 2 or 3 weeks differences in the timeline. How is that possible? There is this nonlinearity. Well, it's because actually the system feels the traffic reduction in a logarithmic way. And so this is a nonlinear, at the end, effect of the system that is very important to plan for the epidemic. Well, you also get epidemiological explanations, like, you know, you can measure through simulations things that you generally not access in the reality, like what is the, you know, the transmission in the different settings, household, hospitals, funerals. Well, it will take a long time before we have very clean data about that from the field. With the simulation, you can start to project results, to get an understanding of what is going on, to get better prediction on the number of cases, because you consider, for instance, the household structure in the model that gives those effects that Sam was mentioning before. You have local communities, and when the epidemic gets as infected, the local community doesn't continue like a branching process. So, you know, there are all those things that are very important. Epidemiological explanation, for instance, by including the mobility. At a certain point, we had a model that was a full agent-based model for Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea, in which we were looking at the local household structure. There were our collaborators going on Google Maps to count roofs in villages, just to give you the level of the details you can go, you can produce in these models. And then you see that, for instance, the spatiotemporal spreading of the disease, it's determined mostly by the interaction within the household and the extended household, and the seeking of healthcare. So obviously there are long-range events, like people visiting one place, going to a market, and then being stuck there sick. But generally, you know, the most important phenomenon is actually the long-range distancing of household with the, for instance, you have a household with a few elements of the family, and then you have the grandparents in another household in another village. But then you call your grandparents to say, okay, I have a problem, I have somebody I have to take care. And then the disease spread to that other village. So you can do all those kind of things. And the last things I want to mention is that really models are important for the structured reasoning. What it is? That, for instance, you can do counterfactual experiments. You do intervention on the ground. It's very difficult to say. It's more important to have Ebola treatment units or funeral safe burial teams on the ground. Well, with the models, you can do that. You can have a model that has all the components, and then you switch off one of the components and keep the other alive. And you can measure, you know, for each of those interventions, what is the number of averted cases that you can expect from that intervention. So this you cannot be done if not with the modeling perspective. You can say it's an accurate enough, the assumption that you have in the model are enough, but we need the model to do those. And so, you know, my two cents is, in a sense, is that the modeling is important, and this is something that is in our Midas paper, is important not despite because of the lack of data in many cases, but just because of the lack of data. The fact that you cannot access certain data, the only way that you can go to understand the phenomena and get a little bit of understanding of what's going on is through the model. And so this is actually even, in a sense, gives a much more perspective than just the forecast, just what is the number of cases that you expect for tomorrow. Let me just, in 30 seconds, tell you, okay, this is a metaphor that we can use in epidemics, but I think there are exciting areas that we are opening with the very exact same framework. It's enough that you go from this geography, that space that determines the epidemic, to, you know, the social space. So our friendship, our interaction on Facebook, our interaction on Twitter, So this is the social space. It's much more complex. And for many years, we were not able to measure this space. Now we can access this space. And so we can use the metaphor of contagion for many other things, that is knowledge spreading, political consensus, memes, information, et cetera, et cetera, that we can now, you know, in a sense, access through data, and then we can get models that can tell us a lot about those phenomena. And you know, this is, for instance, is an example from of a work we are doing in collaboration with Yamir Moreno in Zaragoza. This is the protest in Spain of the 15th of May, and this is Twitter signal. You can analyze the Twitter signal of that protest that was actually an emergent phenomenon. Nobody was anticipating it, it was not coordinated. And you can look really now not just at the network of contacts, but you can look at what people was thinking. So you can understand what is the power of that. You are now accessing really what people, why this phenomenon has emerged and why it has led us into something that is a macroscopic social collective phenomenon. And I think we are approaching the moment at which we will be able to do analysis and forecasting in those areas with all the caveats and issues about ethical and privacy concerns, etc., etc. So thank you very much. I think this is going a very exciting field, and I'm really glad to be here in a place in which you know, you are leading the science in this area. Thank you.